Good evening and welcome to our midweek message, our call to prayer. And this evening we're going to be looking at Psalm 136 and thinking about what it means to pray that psalm for ourselves, how we can use it and inhabit it to pray in the same way that the psalmist prayed, but thinking about the things of our lives here and now. And what got me thinking about this was that on Easter Day, the Anglican Church has set readings. It has readings for each service that might happen over Easter. And I was really struck that the readings for the night vigil, which I was trying to I was just looking at in the morning of Easter Sunday, and morning prayer for Easter Sunday. There are loads of readings that you can do, but there's one that you kind of have to do, which is from Exodus chapters 14 and 15. And I was really struck, who decided that it was really important that we look at the story of the Israelites leaving Egypt and crossing the Red Sea on Easter Sunday? Why the link between the Red Sea and leaving Egypt and Easter Sunday? And I think it's because when we look at the resurrection, and when we look at the cross and we look at all that Jesus did for us, it's kind of like a new exodus has happened. For the church, even from early times, there have been parallels drawn between Christ and the Passover and the Passover lamb. Paul in 1 Corinthians 5 talks about Jesus as the Passover lamb that's been sacrificed for us. And that in the same way that death kind of passed over the Israelite houses in Egypt at Passover, so too, the sin and the consequences of that sin pass over us when we come to Christ. And so it's like we've experienced a new exodus in our hearts from the things of life that would try and trap us, in the same way that God's people in the Old Testament left Egypt through the Red Sea. It was almost like that was a model for what would later come with Christ and the cross and his resurrection. So I thought we would look at something of that story from one of the Psalms, Psalm 136. As we continue to sort of celebrate Easter this week, let's look back at that parallel between the old Exodus and the new Exodus that we experience today. So I wonder if you'd turn with me to Psalm 136. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods, his love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, his love endures forever. To him who alone does great wonders, his love endures forever. Who by his understanding made the heavens, his love endures forever. Who spread out the earth upon the waters, his love endures forever. Who made the great lights, his love endures forever. The sun to govern the day, his love endures forever. The moon and stars to govern the night, his love endures forever. To him who struck down the firstborn of Egypt, his love endures forever. And brought Israel out from among them, his love endures forever. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. To him who divided the Red Sea asunder, his love endures forever. And brought Israel through the midst of it, his love endures forever. But swept Pharaoh and his army into the Red Sea, his love endures forever. To him who led his people through the wilderness, his love endures forever. To him who struck down great kings, his love endures forever. And killed mighty kings, his love endures forever. Sihon, king of the Amorites, his love endures forever. And Og, king of Bashan, his love endures forever. And gave their land as an inheritance, his love endures forever. An inheritance to his servant Israel, his love endures forever. He remembered us in our low estate, his love endures forever. And freed us from our enemies, his love endures forever. He gives food to every creature, his love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of heaven. His love endures forever. In this psalm, there are, for me, kind of six themes around which the psalmist gives thanks. There's God's titles, who he is, who the psalmist addresses God as. There's God's role in creation, how God created the universe. There's God's role in the people's salvation, how God saved his people in Egypt. Then there's God's role in leading his people through the wilderness. And then finally, God's role in bringing them into the promised land. And at the very end, God's love. And around those six themes, I'd like us to just look through that psalm again and see how the psalmist gives thanks for those things, and then how we might give thanks for those things. And each time I'm going to invite you to jot down a few thoughts of, for each theme, what it might look like for you to give thanks to God. And then at the very end, we're going to kind of have our own version almost of Psalm 136, where we can look down and see how God has been with us in wilderness times, has brought us out of difficult spots like in Egypt, offers us eternal life, it's a promised land. And we'll be able to use that as a psalm to help us give thanks during this time as we reflect on Easter and all it means, and as we reflect on the challenges and situations we might face at the moment. So if you grab a pen and a paper or open up a notes app on your phone, and if possible, keep Psalm 136 there as well. I'm just going to go through it, look at those six themes. How do we give thanks like the psalmist did? How do we pray this and inhabit this psalm for ourselves? So number one, God's titles. Give thanks to the God of gods, give thanks to the Lord of lords, to him who alone does great wonders. The psalmist starts by zooming out of his own personal experience and focusing on who God is and using some of those titles, God of gods, Lord of lords. And it's so good to remember that God is so far and above and beyond what we could possibly get our heads around. He's so kind of lofty, isn't he? If we think about who God is above the whole universe, created everything, sovereign over it all. He's eternal, able to create with just words. He's above all authorities and powers. One of my favourite hymns starts with these words. How shall I sing that majesty which angels do admire? What words could I possibly use to describe the majesty of God? And yet, even though God is so far and beyond kind of who we are and what we could possibly understand, the amazing thing is of how he draws near to us, particularly in Jesus. Jesus, fully God, and yet a person, a little child, born like all of us, walked in this world, experienced the temptations we experience, walks upon the same ground we walk, and speaks to people in their language, in ways that they'll understand. The unspeakable, immeasurable majesty of God, suddenly, intimately present to us and with us in the person of Jesus, and then eventually, by the power of the Holy Spirit, coming to live in each of us, Christ in us, the hope of glory. And so I wonder what titles we might use for God. I wonder how we might describe him as people of the new Exodus. The writer of Revelation says, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. And Paul writes, the blessed and only ruler who alone is immortal and who lives in unapproachable light. Peter and the other disciples eventually call Jesus the Messiah. And the Pharisees rightly call Jesus the friend of sinners. I wonder which of those titles strikes you most, King, Saviour, Lord, Friend. Why not write down three titles that of God that really speak to your heart, maybe of his majesty and kind of lofty above and beyondness, or maybe of his intimately presentness and holding those things together. So maybe three titles for God. Think about that now and just jot them down as we go. That will form the first part of our own psalm. Number two, God's role in creation. Who by his understanding made the heavens, who spread out the earth upon the waters, who made the great lights, the sun to govern the day, the moon and stars to govern the night. the psalmist turns to how God created the world and everything in it, and not just the earth, this planet, but the whole universe, the stars, the great lights, the galaxies that we see. God's created the whole universe, and as we unravel more about the mystery of that universe, we discover more of the glory of God in all that he's made, the expanse of his creation. And it's similar to what we've been looking at just now with God's titles. There's something of the sovereign power of God that he can create all of this in a way that we totally couldn't. But there's something amazing about that, because he has such power. And it's so good that he does, because that means he has power to change things and power to change things in our lives. And it also means that, staggeringly, he's created all these things for us to enjoy. He's made us to delight in his creation, in the things that he has made for us. And that's just a staggering wonder for us as we look out the window, maybe on days like today, and we see the beauty of the sunshine and all that he's made. So I wonder if you could jot down four or five of your favourite aspects of creation, four or five things that maybe speak to you about the power of God, maybe the mountains or the galaxies that speak of his greatness, and maybe also something like the petals of a flower or the smell of a rose, and that speak of just God's abundant love to give us wonderful things to smell, to see, to enjoy, even in the small details of creation. So four or five things, your favourite aspects of creation, jot them down now. Number three, God's role in his people's salvation. To him who struck down the firstborn of Egypt and brought Israel out from among them with a mighty hand and outstretched arm. To him who divided the Red Sea asunder and brought Israel through the midst of it, but swept Pharaoh and his army into the Red Sea. We might find verse 10 quite shocking. Did God really have to strike down all the firstborn in Egypt? And yet that was the only thing that finally led to Pharaoh letting God's people go. After 9 other plagues and warnings, which clearly showed that God was God, that he was real, and clearly showed what God wanted, to let his people go from their torturous slavery, Pharaoh still ignored all of the warnings until God did something really drastic. The Israelites had been enslaved to the Egyptians for almost 430 years, and during that time they'd suffered horrendous things. They'd had this forced labour where they were constantly making bricks and other things, where they were beaten by their overlords and whipped, where they were killed. There are the stories when Moses was born that all the Hebrew boys were to be killed, either by the midwives or then eventually by anyone who was supposed to take the Hebrew boys and throw them into the Nile. Such shocking treatment of people, and it didn't change until God did something really drastic. Their slavery didn't come to an end until that final plague and God doing something really dramatic. When we are enslaved to addictions in our own lives, to the things we try and use to make ourselves feel better, perhaps alcohol or Netflix or even good things like exercise, but where we are enslaved by them, when we prioritise them at other people's expense, prioritise ourselves over other people maybe in order to kind of get hold of those things. We too are diminished, just as the Israelites were diminished and the Egyptians were trying to kind of wipe them away almost. We too are so impacted and almost wiped away, the people that we were created to be, by those things that enslave us, until God did something drastic and gave his own firstborn. That we might be free from all those things that enslave us to sin and to our destructive habits. Recently, I've been listening to a song called Egypt by the American songwriter Corey Asbury, and he writes these words. You stepped into my Egypt and you took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom into the promised land. Now I will not forget you, no, I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. What was your Egypt? What were you enslaved to before you met with Jesus? What was it? Maybe an addiction, or maybe just a destructive habit or pattern of life? Or maybe a fear? For me, it was success. I felt I needed to succeed. If I didn't, that I'd maybe be rejected, or just had this desire to kind of constantly be performing well, and really struggled with failure. And when I met with Jesus, it reminded me and showed me that actually God accepts me for who I am before I've performed or done anything, and that he can take even my worst failures and turn them around and use them for good. But that above all, he loves me and accepts me without any sense of performance. What's your Egypt? What was the thing that God changed in your life and brought you out of when you came to know him? Let's jot down four or five ways in which you might have seen that in your own life. Four or five things that changed or have changed since you've come to know Jesus. Four or five things which are now in the past because of his love and the way in which he's stepped into your Egypt and brought you out of those struggles and trials. Let's take a few minutes to jot those things down now. Number four, God's guidance in the wilderness. To him who led his people through the wilderness, to him who struck down great kings and killed mighty kings, Sihon, king of the Amorites, and Og, king of Bashan. My old pastor at university was always telling us that salvation is an event and a process. There's the event where you meet with Jesus and you encounter the living God and you're saved. You put your trust in him, you experience maybe something of his love or just that conviction that he's real. And then there's the process, there's the journey of day by day trying to bring more of your life under his lordship, trying to surrender more of who we are to God and have him impact more and more of our life. And it was the same for Israel. They've been taken out of Egypt and they're now in the wilderness, but they had to then have Egypt taken out of them. In the wilderness, they're complaining, yearning for the comforts that they had back in Egypt, even though they'd been under slavery. And so began their wandering in the wilderness in order to grow in their dependence on God. They had tough times in the wilderness, wondering whether God would come through for them, whether he would provide water or food. They had battles facing kings like Sihon and Og. They had to face these battles and would have suffered during them. They struggled to fully depend on the presence of God that was with them, even though that was enough for their circumstances. And in Deuteronomy 8, Moses says to the Israelites these words, "Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the wilderness these 40 years to humble and test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Your clothes did not wear out and your feet did not swell during these 40 years." Let's take a few moments now to jot down four or five ways in which God has led you through times of struggle. Maybe there are things you're still struggling with, where you're grateful that God is leading you. If the previous theme was things that God has totally set us free from since coming to know him, then these are things which maybe we're still struggling with, where God is still leading us through a wilderness, and we're still trusting and praying and working with God to see freedom in those areas of our lives. Let's take a few minutes to jot those down now. Thank you. number 5, the promised land, and gave their land as an inheritance to his servant Israel. For the church today, if the new exodus is from slavery to sin through the cross, the promised land is eternal life, beginning here and now, and perhaps with some times of wilderness, but leading one day to the total freedom of eternity in heaven with God. The Israelites were in the wilderness for a lifetime for some of them, but eventually they did reach the promised land. Eventually God's people inherited the land which he had promised and brought them to. And for us, our inheritance is the kingdom of God. Luke 12:32. Fear not, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. If Christ is the King and we are his brothers and sisters as children of God, then we are fellow heirs with him, and so princes and princesses in the kingdom. And so one day we will get to reign with Christ in heaven, where our hearts and motives will be totally pure. We will be free from temptation and evil, and will be free from pain, disease and suffering. That is the inheritance to which we can look forward. That is the promised land where we will eventually end up in heaven with our Father. Can you think of 2 to 3 things that you're really grateful for about heaven and what it's going to be like? And why don't we jot those down now and before moving on? And finally, God's love. He remembered us in our low estate and freed us from our enemies. He gives food to every creature. In just these 3 verses, we can see 3 wonderful aspects of God's love. Firstly, his grace. He remembers us in our low estate. We haven't done anything to deserve God's love. But because we're his children, he loves us because he loves us because he loves us. And there's nothing we could do to make him love us any less, or nothing we could do to make him love us any more. And when we're feeling low, when we are feeling guilty maybe of something we've done and we just feel wretched, he remembers us in our lowest state, and like any parent, wants to welcome us back to him with open arms. He remembers us in our lowest state. His grace is always there for us. Secondly, his freedom. He freed us from our enemies. We've already written down maybe some of those enemies that we feel that God has freed us from through the cross. Some of the sinful patterns or destructive habits that we might have had. Is there one in particular that you're really grateful for? 3, his provision. He gives food to every creature. I'm so grateful at the moment for the basic provisions God gives. For food, shelter, friends and family to talk to by phone or over Zoom, for some nice weather that brings out the beauty of creation and lifts my spirits. I'm so grateful for God's provision. What are you grateful for from his provision this week? How are you grateful for God's grace, for freedom from enemies, for his provision? Jot down those 3 things now: his grace, his freedom, his provision. As we come to an end with this. Give thanks to the God of heaven. It's my hope that in writing out these kind of ideas or these things that we're grateful for in our own lives, we'll be able to inhabit this psalm. On my desk behind me, I've got my clerical collars, these bits of plastic that I put into my shirts, my clerical shirts when I'm out and about, maybe going to bump into people that don't often come to church, or if I've got to kind of be in an official meeting. And every clergy person across the country has got collars like this, and we inhabit them differently. We're all different people when we put them on, and the meaning we give to that collar will be different for each of us. The times when we'll think it's appropriate to wear it, the times when we might want to avoid wearing it. And what does it look like for us to inhabit this psalm, to pray it for ourselves, for our own lives, to capture the same sense of it that the psalmist had when they wrote it, being delighted at being freed from slavery in Egypt, to that Exodus, that first Exodus? What does it look like for us as people of Easter, the new Exodus, to be freed from slavery to sin and to be grateful for God's acts in our own lives? So I'm going to pray in a second, and then there'll be some music and some silence in which you might want to write up those different things and to always intersperse them with "His love endures forever." To have those aspects on God's titles, on God in creation, God in salvation, God in the wilderness, God bringing us into the promised land and heaven, and God's love, and what it looks like for those things to be true in our lives. So let me pray now, and then we can take some time to write those up and to give thanks to the God of gods, whose love endures forever. Heavenly Father, thank you that your love endures forever. Thank you that you are the same God who led the Israelites out of slavery in Egypt to the promised land. And thank you that you do that for each of us through your Easter story, through all that you did on the cross and the resurrection. Lord, you bring freedom to our lives, and we are so grateful. You bring us out of the things that would keep us ensnared and trapped, and you bring us into places of freedom and dependence on you. So Lord, thank you for your love for us, and help us to give thanks now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Forever God is strong. sing praise.